Calvary Spokane from the Sullivan family. We miss you guys. We hope you're all doing well. Thanks for joining us online. And we're really looking forward to when we can all get back together in person.
Love you guys. Miss you.
Hi, church. We're the Jensen family. And we love you so much. Thank you.
And we miss you. And we cannot wait to see everyone face to face.
We hope this time goes by fast and we can be with you guys together, worshiping in the same roof one day. Thanks so much.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Greetings, Calvary Chapel Spokane. This is Sam and Ann Simmons. We pray that you're feeling God's peace and comfort during these unsettling times. We look forward daily to Ken's video logs to keep our eyes focused on where they should be, on Jesus. We miss seeing you and meeting together and pray for the time when once again, God willing, we'll be able to do so. May His blessings be on you.
Hello and welcome to service. My name is Diane, and I'm the Women's Event Coordinator here at Calvary Spokane. Today, Pastor Ken will be continuing in his series on the birth of the church. We're going to be studying in Acts chapter 9, verses 20 through 31. So get your Bibles ready, and we'll read that passage together soon. But right now, I'd like to invite you to worship together and sing praises to our Lord.
Jesus, we come before you and we lift up our praise and our adoration to your name. We thank you for this amazing grace that you've saved us with. We love you, Lord. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. You would take my place. You would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations. Truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. And you would take my place. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life.
Lord, we thank you that you gave yourself, that your blood was poured out for the forgiveness of our sins, and that you were nailed to that cross as the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world for the sins of the world. You are worthy, and we worship you. In your name we pray. Amen.
My name is Sean. I'm going to be reading today's passage out of Acts chapter 9, starting right before verse 20. And it reads, Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. All those who heard him were astonished and asked, Isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on this name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priests? Yet Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Messiah. After many days had gone by, there was a conspiracy among the Jews to kill him. But Saul learned of their plan. Day and night they kept close watch on the city gates in order to kill him. But his followers took him by night and lowered him in a basket through an opening in the wall. When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul, on his journey, had seen the Lord, and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. He talked and debated with the Hellenistic Jews, and they tried to kill him. When the believers learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent off to Tarsus. Then the church throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria enjoyed a time of peace and was strengthened. Living in the fear of the Lord and encouraged by the Holy Spirit, it increased in numbers.
Welcome and thanks again for joining with us as we continue our verse-by-verse study through the book of Acts. This series is one I've entitled The Birth of the Church. And last week we began looking at the role that the Apostle Paul played, not only in the beginnings of the early church, but eventually really creating much of the template that modern Christianity operates off of today. But this message I call the Refiner's Fire, and hopefully as I go through the passage, you'll understand why I titled that. But let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for this time that we have together. I pray that you would open your word to our hearts, to our minds, that our understanding would be enlightened, God, and our hearts would be strengthened and encouraged, that we might be more certain of what we believe and be able to live it more forthrightly. Give us that grace today, Lord, we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. A question that has puzzled historians for centuries, especially in the modern era, is how it was that Christianity could grow from a small, insignificant Jewish sect, one that was barely noticed outside of Judea, to become today the largest, the most widespread religious movement in the world. I mean, Christianity exists on every continent and just about in every nation on the earth. And in fact, in some countries where it is still illegal to be a Christian, we still find that the church is functioning and operating. In fact, its growth was rather kind of amazing from the very beginning, because within the first 200 years of its existence, it literally overtook the entire Roman Empire, so much so that eventually Emperor Constantine declared that Christianity was no longer an illegal religion and it was legal to practice the faith. Now, some have mistakenly said that he made Christianity the state religion of Rome, but that was never the case. He just said that Christians were free to worship just as every other group was able to experience religious freedom and expression. And yet, when this happened, the church just continued to expand so that ultimately, over the next 100 or so years, Christianity became the predominant religious force, not only in Rome, but throughout what was the Roman Empire and beyond. And what's amazing about this and why it causes so many questions is because nothing about this group seemed to really predict that it would have this kind of effect. I mean, not only was its leader killed in the most dramatic and inglorious way, but they had no buildings. They had no public ceremonies in which they could display their faith. In fact, it was widely ridiculed. There was no mass media that they could advertise. And as I said before, for a significant amount of time, it was illegal to practice Christianity. And so it was carried out in secret. Nor can we look at the people who followed the faith and say it was because of these mavens or influence makers, these influencers who suddenly shifted the focus of the culture. In fact, by admission, the Apostle Paul wrote to the Corinthians and said, "Not many of you were wise by human standards, not many were influential or of noble birth." Rather, he goes on to say, in the eyes of the world, they were foolish, they were weak, they were lowly, and generally just said they were people who were despised. And it didn't help that the very heart of their message was cultural barrier. That, in other words, it wasn't a message that appealed to either Greeks or Jews. In fact, we know amongst that Paul makes a statement to the Corinthians again that we preach Christ crucified, which is a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. Now, why would he say that? Well, to the Jews, they would go to Deuteronomy chapter 21, 23, where it says that anyone who was hung on a tree is under a curse. So that Jesus being hung on a cross, what would be considered to be a tree, and therefore, even today, many Orthodox say, Jesus couldn't be the Messiah because he was cursed of God. As Christians, we don't disagree. In fact, we affirm it because he became a curse on our behalf. He took the curse of sin. That's why he hung on the cross. But on up front, most Jews would have rejected this out of hand, saying it's ridiculous to think that a man who was hung on a tree, who was crucified by the Romans, could possibly be our Messiah. And likewise, when you talk to the Roman, he would say, basically, anybody who was crucified was the lowest order of criminal. I mean, only slaves and people who were the worst rebellious or insurrectionists were crucified in that manner. And so it was something that was not only horrific in its execution, but people who experienced it were really considered to be cast off and forgotten. They were people who no longer had any value or worth within the Roman and the Greek world. And in fact, the proof of that is found in a very interesting way. In an excavation of a Roman school dating back to the second century, the archaeologists found scrawled on the wall this interesting piece of graffiti. It looks like something that a school child would have written. But basically, what it is a sketch of a man with a raised hand, and he's worshiping or reverencing a character who is hanging on the cross, and the character has the body of a man, but it has the head of a mule. And the inscription underneath it in Latin says, "Aleximanos worships his God." In other words, they looked at Christ as having the head of a jackass, and they said, that's the God that Christians are worshiping. It clearly confirms kind of the warning that Jesus gave his disciples when he said in Luke 21:17, "All men will hate you because of me." And this is still true today, unfortunately. I mean, Christians still remain the most hated, the most vilified, disparaged, discriminated against, persecuted, and even martyred group of people on the planet today. I mean, it's so characteristic of what it means to be a follower of Christ that it really has become part of our history, the idea that we have this long list of martyrs. And the numbers are far greater than most people realize. For example, from the time of Christ's death in about 33 AD up till the 1900, we know that there were about 14 million Christians who were martyred. Just in the last century, from 1900 to 2000, there was 26 million Christians persecuted, murdered, killed, and martyred for their faith. I mean, an astounding number. Just in Turkey alone, the Armenian Christians, over 2 million of them were killed in the Armenian genocide early in the beginning of the 19th century. But currently, even today, when things are actually kind of slowing down a bit, that each year, there's documented at least about 160,000 Christians who are martyred every year. They suffer death because of their faith. And it's happening in places that probably wouldn't surprise us, but never gets covered in the news. It's happening in China even now. It's happening in North Korea and in India, southern Mexico, South America, and certainly within the Middle East. It's not uncommon in even parts of the Sudan and Africa where many Christians are suffering for their faith because they won't deny Christ. Yet despite such consistent and concerted effort to wipe Christianity off the face of the earth, there are places where Christianity not only still exists, but it is vibrant and growing. In fact, Christianity today is the fastest growing religious movement in the world, contrary to all the claims by everybody else. In fact, it's also the largest. Over 2 billion people on the planet today claim to be followers of Jesus Christ. So again, the historian asks the question, not only why and how do they continue to exist, but why are they so vilified? Well, you know, it's interesting. Unlike most things in life, there is an inverse relationship between the cost of converting and the commitment to Christ that comes when people are willing to pay that cost. We might simply say that the higher the cost to follow Christ, the deeper the commitment that comes from those who choose to do so. No one understood this better than Saul of Tarsus, who our passage is talking about. He had been the church's chief persecutor, having done, as it says in Acts chapter 8 and 9, that he ravaged the church. He drug off men and women, putting them in prison. He did much evil or harm to the saints. That's what he was known at. The Christians were frankly and honestly and justifiably terrified of him and had trouble accepting him into the fellowship just because of his past reputation. Yet even more dramatic than his persecution of the church was a sudden and unprecedented conversion to Christ that he said came to him through a vision on the road to Damascus. Well, not surprising, we're told in the text that the Jews were astonished by his faith, or we might translate it astounded. In fact, when you look at the synonyms for words like astounded or astonished, there are things like overwhelmed, to be befuddled, startled, stunned, thunderstruck, confounded, dumbfounded, dumbstruck, stupefied. I think you could put all those words together and say it was so inconceivable that this man who was such a hater of Christianity would in fact convert to the very faith that he set out to destroy that they just didn't know where to go with it. Initially, we're told they are so thrown off that the word that's used in the text is baffled. They were baffled not only by his conversion, but it said that he was proving to them, from Scripture undoubtedly, that Jesus was the Christ, the very thing that he had sought to silence. So that because they were unable to refute his arguments, they did what people often do when they can't win an argument. The Jews conspired to kill him, the text says. Well, not only did that attempt not succeed, And I would simply say, not because his friends found out about it and secreted him out of the city of Damascus. It didn't succeed because it wasn't time for Paul to go home to be with the Lord. And it's one of those concepts that I hold to pretty strongly. I think that God is the only one who controls the meter of my life. And when my time is up, it's going to be over, and there's nothing I can do to keep it, and there's nothing I can do to hasten it. So my life is in the hands of God. Paul's life was in God's hands, and God was not going to allow Paul to be cut off before he had had the opportunity to use him up for his own purposes in this world. So basically, we're told that his followers took him by night and lowered him in a basket through an opening in the wall of the city of Damascus. But see, even that did not accomplish their purposes, because like scattering embers into dry grass, instead of containing the flames of faith that were burning in Paul and beginning to touch other people around him, they simply fanned those embers into flame and became a burning wildfire around the world. Luke actually leaves a little bit of a gap in his account in Acts that fortunately Paul fills into us in his letters to the Corinthians and also to the Galatians. Listen to how he talked about what took place in 2 Corinthians 11:32. He says, "In Damascus, the governor under King Aretas IV had the city of Damascus, guarded in order to arrest me. But I was lowered in a basket from a window in the wall and slipped through their hands." He tells us then in Galatians 1:16 through 18, he says, "I went immediately into Arabia." Now you have to understand that what was called Arabia in Paul's day is different than what we call Arabia today. Some people don't understand that distinction and draw some funny conclusions. But literally, the place of Arabia was just south of Damascus. It was a region or a kingdom called Nabatea. Aretas IV was a Roman client king, and he ruled over what was called the Decapolis, the 10 Greek cities. Now, his capital was in the city of Petra, which today is in modern-day Jordan, but these were all these cities that were directly below it, inland from the coast of Israel. And we find that it appears that Paul spent the next 3 years basically evangelizing Greek Gentiles in those cities, as well as ministering to many Jews. But he said, finally, he returned to Damascus, and after those 3 years, he says, "I went up to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Peter and stayed with him for 15 days. This was the beginning of what I referred to as Paul's peripatetic mission. Peripatetic is a strange word, I know, but it simply means that you travel around in order to accomplish a work. It's like a traveling workman who goes from place to place, and that's what Paul's life became. He planted churches. He didn't settle in anyone, but his goal was to plant the gospel, he said, where it had never been preached before. It's estimated that Paul traveled someplace between 20 to 30,000 miles, mostly by foot, sometimes by ship. And that was all covered in this period of 33 years from 35 AD when he is converted to 68 AD when he is executed. So that's kind of an amazing amount of time when you think about by foot he was covering 1 to 2 to 3,000 miles a year traveling from place to place. It's probably not an exaggeration to say that Paul, by the time of his death, was the most traveled man of his age. People just didn't move around like that because it was physically hard, it was dangerous, and it was expensive to do. And so there were very few people, if any, aside from Paul and the other missionaries, who actually went to the effort to travel around, especially to places that were unfamiliar to them. But the reason why he did this was simply a fulfillment of what God said his call was when we talked last week about the anointing that was given him when Ananias laid hands on him. God told Ananias in chapter 9, verse 15, "This man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles, their kings, and before the people of Israel." And this is exactly what we find him going all around the world, talking to Gentiles, but not just the people, but also being brought in before the rulers of cities and kingdoms and even the Roman Empire itself, where he got a chance to talk to the Emperor of Rome and give his testimony of how he came to Christ. Well, getting back to Paul fleeing out of Damascus, it appears that he spent, as it said, 3 years evangelizing the Gentile Greeks in this region of the Decapolis, referred to as Arabia by Paul. But he eventually returns to Damascus, and it's his effectiveness probably in that evangelism that led the governor of Damascus to seek to arrest him, probably for the purpose of sending him back to Jerusalem to have him tried before the Sanhedrin. But it's also during this time that Paul tells us something personal about himself in his letter to the Philippians. He says that he had suffered the loss of all things. You see, because Paul was a rabbi before he became a Christian, he was married of necessity. He would have had to be married, and he undoubtedly had children. But now that he's teaching that, quote, Jesus is the Son of God, and by proving that Jesus is the Christ, the chief priest would have applied the ruling or the judgment of God in Deuteronomy 13, where it says, if your brother, son, daughter, wife, or closer friend entices you, saying, let us go and worship other gods, show him no pity, you must certainly put him to death. So there was really a sentence of death, you might say, on Paul's life, even a possibility of a form of a warrant out to get him and have him punished for what he was doing. This would also explain why 3 years later, after his return to Jerusalem, he is there for such a short period of time. He goes on and says he talked and he debated with the Grecian Jews, but they tried to kill him. These probably were the same Grecian Jews that had been part of his synagogue before he became a believer. And when the brothers learned of this, that is the church leaders learned of it, they took him down to Caesarea, which is on the coast, and they sent him off to Tarsus. In other words, they put him on a boat and said, go home. By his own count, his stay in Jerusalem was only 15 days, so it was like a two-week vacation. He says in Galatians 1:18, he says, I went up to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Peter and stayed with him 15 days. So after spending almost 3 years traveling on the road, I mean, he went from Jerusalem to Damascus where he met the Lord. He went to Damascus into Arabia or Nabatea. He went from Nabatea back to Damascus, Damascus down to Jerusalem, and now Jerusalem back to Tarsus. That's a journey of about 3,000 miles just in itself, and Paul hasn't even begun his evangelistic ministries. But one of the things that's real interesting is that after this, Paul doesn't really go anyplace. For the next 13 years, he stays in Tarsus. He becomes part of the family business of tent makers, and we believe that they were making tents for the Roman army. And he basically became part of the community, part of the family, and lived in what we call a relative anonymity. The natural question we might have is, why therefore did God sidetrack such a powerful tool for the gospel? And I would just simply say that, like the old saying that Rome wasn't built in the day, neither is an apostle built in a short period of time. There were a whole lot of things that Paul needed to learn, and there were a whole lot of things that he needed to unlearn. And that becomes fairly evident as we read his letters in the New Testament, that God really took him through a long season and maybe a lifelong season of spiritual refinement. Most importantly, he had to learn that ministry success is, as the prophet Zechariah put it in Zechariah 4:6, it's not by might, it's nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty. I wonder if it's when Paul came to learn that you know, when God said to him simply, in my strength, or in your weakness, you're going to discover my strength. It's such an oxymoronic concept to us because we think we go from strength to strength and power to power. And God says, no, my math, my sacred math operates in a whole different way, that if you seek to do things in your power, you'll find how weak you really are. But if you trust in my power, you'll discover a strength that is bigger and greater and far beyond your own. So that essentially, how do we break this down? Well, the effective means of ministry is not based simply on somebody's natural abilities. We often fall into that trap. We say, well, he's so gifted, he's so talented, he's so intelligent, and therefore he should be effective for Christ. I have to say that Not only have I seen that not necessarily happen, I've often found the opposite is true. I mean, I take myself as a point in case. I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer. But it's interesting because when he says it's not by might, what he's talking about, might? Well, it's your might is your intellect, your education, your talent, your skill, your cunning, your cleverness, all those kind of things that we think that enable a person to become impactful in their life. And God says, no, it isn't because of any of those things. And then we say, well, maybe it's an inherent power that somebody has. That is, you have resources, you have connections, you have wealth, you're networked, you have a force of will, a determination, you have passion or a driving ambition. And again, God says, no, that isn't it either. That's not where my power flows. That's often selfish ambition and self-desire that's driving you, but it will run out of energy very, very quickly. But Paul, and that's what's interesting about Paul, because in some ways he possessed all of these natural abilities. These resources were his, you might say, in spades. And one day we'll see that God does use those things that he has, but first those things had to be tamed. They had to be brought under the total submission of God, under the controlling hand of God, so that in the end when Paul writes to the Corinthians in chapter 15 of the first letter, he says, I am what I am, by the grace of God. In other words, he doesn't attribute any of his success to anything that was in him naturally, inherently, or acquired through skill or training and education. He says, I have been able to do what I'm doing because God showed me grace. Now, keep in mind, grace is not just a word to talk about how God feels about us. Grace is an empowerment that God gives to us to do what he wants through his power and his ability. So that when we talk about being gracious towards another person, it is implying that God is giving me the capacity to be kind, compassionate, loving, and caring for someone who of my own natural inclinations would never be the focus of my concern. So that what we find is that Paul kind of had to learn what Jesus said in John 3:6 when he said, flesh gives birth to flesh, but spirit gives birth to spirit. So that if we want to be effective as servants of God, we have to come to grips with the fact that if I'm going to do something in my flesh, by my fleshy understanding or intellect or ability or talent or skill or might and power, all I can do is reproduce after the same kind. And the problem with flesh is, as we talked about a few weeks ago, we came from dust and we're going to return to dust. And so everything that we build by human energy will simply go the way of all time. It'll go from dust and return then once again to dust. But things that are spiritual things are not material. They are eternal and they last. And so he says, when the Spirit of God is inside of you and working and moving in your life, you have the ability to produce things that will bear fruit for all time and eternity. And that's why Jesus would say, abide in me in John 15, I'm the good vine. And he says, abide in me and you will bring fruit. And herein is my Father glorified in that you bring forth much fruit, fruit that lasts. Well, that means that we're allowing the Holy Spirit to be the guiding, empowering principle of our life and not our own intellect or our own understanding, our own talent or skill set. You know, it would take Paul 13 years to basically learn the very simple principle that the prophet Michael outlined in Micah chapter 6, verse 8, where he said, the Lord has shown you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. And he said these three things, to act justly. Well, as a Jew, Paul understood about acting justly, but he goes on to say, and to love mercy. Sometimes we think we're merciful, but we don't like being merciful. And he says it's a change of heart where you love being merciful to people who, for obvious reasons, don't deserve to be shown mercy. And then lastly, he says to walk humbly with your God. I've often said it, humility is not something that's native to the human character or personality. I do not consider myself a humble man. In fact, I know that I have to keep a sharp check on my heart because pride can rise up so easily. Now, a friend of mine one time said, I don't understand why you struggle with pride. I can't see any reason why you would. And he's probably accurate in that estimation. But the simple fact is that this is something that you and I battle with because we are so I-focused. That's why the middle letter of the word pride is I. It's I-itis. It's the problem we have of thinking the world should revolve around us. And many times we become angry and bitter at life because the world isn't taking its cues from my feelings, my whims, and my desires. In fact, you might say it becomes very apparent many times that they're ignoring what I want. And that's the whole point, to learn that it's not about you, it's not about me, but it's all about Jesus. And that's something that takes a supernatural moving of the Spirit of God in our hearts and our minds to bring us to that kind of realization. That's also why the prophet referred to this as a refiner's fire. In Zechariah 13, 19, he said, "I will bring you into the fire. I will refine you like silver and test you like gold." Now, very few of us have ever refined silver or gold or any other metal for that matter. And so it's kind of a strange concept to us. But understand that gold and silver melt at about 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit. I mean, that is incredibly hot. That's where rock melts. And the process is not only intense in its heat, but the after effect is it brings to the surface the ugly stuff that's in the stone. That's how they purify the gold. As they heat it, the refuse, or the dross as they call it, which is lighter than the ore that's in the rock, rises to the surface. And so all you can see is the impurities. And that's why in refining it, they bring it to the surface, they scrape that off, they allow it to cool, and then they reheat it. In fact, someone asked a silversmith, "When do you know when the silver is pure?" And he says, "When I can see my own face reflected in the pool, in the pot." And that's the interesting thing, because I think that's what God wants to do. He knows that he has finished the work he needs to do in your life, and he can take the heat off when he has brought you to a place in your life where when people look at you, they see the face of Jesus instead of seeing your ugly mug. But also that is necessary, that molding and that melting down of the ore is essential for turning that rock into something that is useful, something that can be forged into a tool, pounded and shaped into a useful form, whether it be something as simple or delicate as jewelry to as important as a hammer that cracks other rocks and drives nails into the ground. This is the process, essentially, that God said Paul needed to go through in order for him to become truly and fully useful, to become a tool that's been forged in the fires of God, in the trials and tribulations, the humiliation and the brokenness and the discouragement. That's something that takes time to accomplish and can't be done quickly. And that's also why Zechariah said in the fourth chapter of that wonderful book, he said, "Do not despise the days of small things." That's our tendency, isn't it? We are waiting for God to do something, and we hate the fact that we're not doing any significant thing. When I first got saved, I was so anxious to win the world for Christ, and I began to find that God spent a lot of time not using me in that way. And I look back on it now and realize why, that so much came out of my mouth and so many parts of my behavior and attitude would have been really an embarrassment to the gospel rather than a help to it, that God knew he needed to keep me in a cloister for a season so that I could really discover what it meant to be a follower of Jesus. But you see, Paul is a new believer. Had to struggle with so much more than you and I do. I mean, he was brilliant and he was bold. I mean, he has natural ability. He has a superior intellect. He has an advanced education over many of his own time. And he had this unquenchable zeal. His base of inner energy is just unbounded. That made him a force just in his natural self to be reckoned with. But what he lacked was that kind of compassionate humility. And I want to suggest to you now, because we'll be beginning to get into it next time, that was something that he eventually had to learn from Barnabas, his companion in ministry years later. And that's why, once again, we find at the end of the reading that it's Barnabas who kind of helps Paul to move forward in his mission in life. And ultimately, it's Barnabas who comes to his ultimate calling. It's Barnabas who introduces him to the church and particularly the apostles so that they will accept him as a true believer, a brother in Christ. It's Barnabas probably who was one of the chief ones to get him out of town and send him back to Tarsus that he wouldn't be killed before time. And ultimately, it's Barnabas who launches Paul into the ministry that would define his life into the future. In chapter 11, in fact, of Acts, in verse 20, it says that some men went to Antioch in Syria, which is a Greek city, part of the Roman Empire, but a Greek-speaking, Greek cultural city, and began to speak to the Greeks, telling them the good news about the Lord Jesus. In other words, some Christians or Jewish Christians started talking to Gentiles about Christ. And a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. News of this reached the ears of the church at Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. We'll have a lot more to say about Barnabas because he's really an underrepresented character of great importance in the story of Acts. But then it says, then Barnabas, seeing the work that needed to be accomplished, went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. And it's at Antioch that we find Paul begins to express himself as the apostle that God had called him to be. So I guess one of the last things I would just simply say is, if you're one of those people who feel like you're kind of waiting for God to do something in your life, waiting him for to use you or to answer a prayer, or to fix a problem, to rescue you from a difficult situation, or as we all find ourselves, we're kind of waiting so that we can have physical interaction and fellowship with one another, and social distancing will no longer be the name of the game. You just need to remember that waiting is an integral part of what God does in forming people. In other words, Abraham had to wait 100 years before Isaac ever showed up. Isaac had to wait 60 years before he had Jacob and Esau. Jacob was 97 when God finally said, "You're no longer Jacob. Your name now is Israel." Joseph languished as a slave and a prisoner for 13 years of his early life, almost half of his life up to that point. It took God 80 years to shape Moses into something that he could use and work through. David had to flee and live as a fugitive for 10 years in the wilderness of Judea. And if you've ever been there, as I have, you realize this is not a place where I'd want to spend a weekend, much less the rest of my life. But even Jesus waited 18 years before he began his public ministry. Remember, he was 12 when he came into the temple and caused the teachers and the rabbis to marvel at his understanding and his knowledge. And yet it says after that, he went home and submitted himself to his parents. And we hear nothing about Jesus until 18 years later, he turns 30 years of age. So if you're in the place where you're waiting for God to do something in your life, don't feel like something strange has happened to you or basically God lost your phone number or your credit card. He knows where you're at. He knows what you're doing. In fact, he knows what he's doing in you. And that's why I think it's so important, instead of wasting the time that you're waiting, start redeeming it by using it to grow in your relationship with Christ. That's why I find that I love the passage James teaches. Well, let me say, I kind of love it. Sometimes I hate it. But when James says in the beginning of his first letter to church, he says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials." That means troublous times. "Knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience, but let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete and lacking nothing." That don't get in a hurry to get to the end of what God is trying to do in your life, but take advantage of those moments. I just want to add in closing that each week I produce with these messages a set of questions. I start with a little dialogue about the focus of what we're talking about. I have a number of questions that I ask, and we use them as individual probes, but also you can use them in small group discussions. Even husband and wives can go over with them. I include with there a list of all the passages that I've quoted in the message, so if you want to go back and check out those passages and read them for yourself, because maybe I went through them too quickly, you can do that. So that's available online, and there's a prompt that will tell you how to get there. But I would encourage you to do that. And we really want to encourage you during this time to get involved in one of our online small groups. Basically, they're Zoom meetings that we do over the internet. Everybody seems to know about Zoom now. If you don't, ask somebody. Ask a 12-year-old, and he or she can tell you all about it. But you can go in there and basically have a live conversation with other people where you can go over this information and share with each other what you've got. One other thing we do is that after we do these messages, we always get together. James and I sit down and kind of go over the information again so that it helps as a prompt for your conversations as we dialogue at length about the very questions that I present each week in this program. So thank you for listening, and looking forward to being with you next time. I'm really looking forward to being in a room with real people in real time, other than a few technicians. But nonetheless, be good, keep safe during this time, and keep on praying that God would move mightily in this land to bring this nation back to the feet of Christ. God bless you and go in His grace.
So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise.
Oh Lord, we know that one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess your lordship. So we give you all the honor and all the glory, God, and we look forward to the day that you return for your church. We thank you that you have just given us your spirit, Lord, that it lives inside of us, that our bodies are the temple. It's not a building. Lord, that you go with us wherever we are. Keep us attentive to your presence. We worship you and we love you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for worshiping with us this weekend. We miss all of you. We're praying for you, and we can't wait to be able to gather right here again soon. Just a reminder, the church is closed to walk-ins during this time, but you can still contact us through mail, email, or phone, so please don't hesitate to reach out to us. There are additional resources at our website, calvaryspokane.com. At that site, you can request prayer for things that are going on in your life. You can speak with or talk with a pastor here. You can also join one of our online small groups during this time. If you're able to continue to support the ministry here at Calvary Spokane, you can also do that through our website or through our Calvary Spokane app. We hope you all have a great week, and we hope that you can join us online again next weekend.